Since the 1950s, in almost every major city in the United States, a silent, almost mythical crime syndicate had been terrorizing America's streets. This new age mafioso was the likes of which the United States had never seen. It seemed that there was only one solution to cracking the Italian mafia. On November 14, 1957, a meeting of the major Italian mafia bosses was to be held in uptown New York, in a small town of Appalachian, at the home of Joe Barbara. This meeting would catch the attention of not only the media through the United States, but the authorities' attention as well. This especially caught the attention of the New York State Trooper, Edgar Crosswell, who was already suspicious of Barbara's criminal activities. Once the news had spread that the state troopers were snooping around the property, the attendees of the meeting began fleeing, some through the woods and others in their stretched limos. All were unaware that there was already a roadblock preventing their escape. An estimated 63 mafioso leaders did not escape. Thanks to good old-fashioned police work by Edgar Crosswell, the media was able to communicate the problems of organized crime to the American people. Because of the increasing pressure by American citizens, the FBI mounted a mass intelligence operation by means of communication interceptions known as the Top Hoodlum Program. Through this program, FBI officials utilized techniques such as wiretapping, bugging, and break-ins to uncover invaluable intelligence about the general plans and associates of organized crime leaders. The Top Hoodlum Program enabled FBI agents to pierce the tight-knit oath of silence by recruiting informers. In June of 1962, Joe Valachi, a member of the New York Genovese crime family, agreed to inform the FBI of the Italian mafia in return for a reduced sentence for his murder conviction.
First of all, I want revenge. That's right. As the senator put it before, what did I get out of it?
What'd you get out of it?
Nothing but misery.
Valachi would communicate with the FBI that the La Cosa Nostra was a strong hierarchy made up of various levels of command. Valachi's communication with the FBI opened new doors for a completely new onslaught of communication interception techniques. The FBI found if they wanted to stop the LCN, they would have to go after the bosses first. The most well-known boss in New York was Paul Castellano. In 1976, Big Paul became boss of the Gambino family about a month after his cousin Carlo passed away. By the early 1980s, he was more powerful and influential than billion-dollar corporations. Bosses of other La Cosa Nostra families often came to him seeking guidance. It seemed that if the FBI wanted to stop the LCN, they would have to start with Paul Castellano. When they had sufficient cause, Kearns and O'Brien agreed to plant a bug in the Todd Hill Mansion, located in Staten Island, where Castellano lived and conducted business. In order to plant a residential bug in Castellano's mansion, known as the White House, the FBI had to obtain proper court authorization, establishing beyond a reasonable doubt that Big Paul was taking part in illegal organized crime activity. The probable cause they achieve must be put into legalized foolproof affidavits to gain permission under the Title III Omnibus Crime Act. Once O'Brien and Kearns gained permission, the planning of the residential bug could occur. The name of the operation was Castaway. Bugging the Todd Hill White House, however, would not be easy, for it boasted a very complex security system. There were security cameras panning back and forth over every point of entry into the house. There were also delicate motion sensors attached to every window and door in the house. Although two Doberman pinchers would probably neutralize any intruder before law enforcement could respond.
The first stage of the operation was to set up a command post on the second and third floors of an abandoned Victorian home located at 1510 Richmond Road. From here, there was a clear view to the White House. In order to form a break-in and enter strategy, the FBI obtained a floor plan of Castellano's mansion from the head of Myron Lumber Company. Julie Myron, the head of the company, did business on a regular basis with Big Paul because of Big Paul's construction business, which he used as a front. Myron drew out a rough floor plan of the house and revealed that Big Paul conducted a majority of his business and spent a great deal of his time in the breakfast nook. While Big Paul was on vacation with his maid and mistress, Gloria Orlarate, Stage 2 of the operation was already swinging into progress. Stage 2 was to neutralize the Doberman pinchers. Two FBI agents dressed as gardeners carried pruning shears, rakes, and two sirloin steaks injected with sleep-inducing serum. At 5:22 p.m., the two FBI agents, stationed 40 feet from one another, were ordered to throw the steaks over the fence. The two Dobermans immediately devoured the steaks. Stage 3 of the operation was the actual break-in, which took place at approximately 1:30 a.m. Three FBI techies, wearing black from head to toe, and carrying walkie-talkies and small-bore automatic pistols, scaled the fence and made their way to the garage. One of the techies, an expert locksmith, picked the lock to the garage in only a few seconds, and the team entered the house. Waiting exactly 25 seconds for another agent to stuff the alarm bullhorn on the top of the roof with foam, the team of three picked the lock leading from the garage to the kitchen and entered the enormous kitchen. Then they deactivated the house's security system using a computerized digital selector. The team moved to Castellano's breakfast nook and placed an omnidirectional microphone with a power pack in the base of the silver upright lamp next to his chair. The entire operation took only 12 and a half minutes. Big Paul said things within earshot of the bug that were foolish and gave valuable information to the FBI about the workings of the Italian mafioso. The omnidirectional microphone, placed in his breakfast nook, provided the FBI with information that would lead to the arrest of the great boss, Paul Castellano. Rudolph Giuliani, attorney of the Southern District of New York, indicted Paul Castellano on RICO, or Racketeering Influence and Corrupt Organizations Act, charges. However, Big Paul would be shot and killed in front of Sparks Steakhouse before he served his prison term. Using communications interceptions, the FBI was able to rid the streets of New York of one of the most prolific mafia bosses of all time.
Over the past 5 decades since the realization of the La Cosa Nostra in America, the FBI has made giant leaps to make America a safer place. The first step in bringing down the La Cosa Nostra was at Appalachian, when a New York State trooper used good judgment. Through his actions, the media could communicate the then unknown problem of organized crime to the American people. This would prove to be the beginning of the fall of the La Cosa Nostra in the United States. Joe Valachi was also a key catalyst in communicating the existence of the Italian Mafia to the people of the United States. He also communicated many of the Mafia's involvements and partnerships, which allowed the FBI to focus its attention on certain criminals. The intelligence gathered during the Top Hoodlum program gave the FBI in-depth profiles of almost every prolific gangster in every major city. After the bugging of Paul Castellano, New York armed itself with an organized crime task force with a $100 million budget, which allowed the increase of electronic communication interceptions. America has been made safer by communication interceptions and communications between the FBI and informants, such as Joseph Valachi. In the end, surveillance would turn out to be the cause of the decline of the Italian Mafia throughout the United States.